Hello, I'm David Brown from the Solidworks training team. This video presents a project that you can use to hone your Solidworks skills and is easy to make if you have a basic 3D printer. This model was the winning entry of a design contest. The challenge was to design a catapult that would adhere to a specific set of parameters, launch a small foam ball, and be powered by a rubber band. The inspiration for this design was the Roman Onager, a siege weapon used to knock down the walls of a fortress employed by the armies of ancient Rome. Due to the nature of its design, it was named Onager because when operated, it kicked like a mule. The key aspects of this design that I will focus on are design intent, part features, part design in context of the assembly, saving to STL files, and 3D printing. Let's get started. One of the main constraints of the design contest was that the models were to follow flat pack design principles. This means the components are mostly flat, minimizing print time and reducing the amount of support material to almost zero. Following these guidelines, I designed this particular model to require no adhesives or fasteners. It just snaps together. The Onager is made of six parts: the side plates, which are identical, front support, back support, and face plate are nested together and printed at the same time. The basket arm is the only component that needs a little support material and is printed by itself. Even though the rubber band and ball are purchase parts, I modeled them anyway to visualize the design better. The faceplate, basket, and rubber band are designed in the context of the assembly, the other parts individually. Here I have the parts put together in a SolidWorks assembly. Since the rubber band and ball are not really part of the build, I created a configuration in the assembly so I can turn them off. I will open the parts individually to show my design approach for each one, starting with the front support at the top of the list. I start with the simple boss extrude with the sketch on the front plane. I have the units set to 4 decimal places just to show you that I'm using a thickness of 3/16 of an inch for the front and back supports. They are a little thicker than the side plates, which are 1/8 of an inch. I chose these values simply because they are numbers I'm used to working with. I added an extruded cut for slots the side plates will fit into. The width of the slot is 2/1000 of an inch larger than the width of the side plate. This tolerance will vary depending on a specific 3D printer. I find this amount of tolerance allows for a snug fit, not too loose that the parts will fall apart, and not too tight that I have to force them together. Refer to the 3D printer results cube project in this playlist for an easy project you can use to test the accuracy of your 3D printer. I created a cut on the back side of the front support. When the model is assembled, the faceplate will rest on this ledge. Finally, I put some fillets on the corners to dress it up a bit. There are many ways to design a part. It all depends on the designer, factoring design intent, personal preferences, and even best practices. What follows is a discussion of my approach to designing in SolidWorks. With the side plate, I have several features: a boss extrude, a few cuts, and some fillets. The sketch that drives the boss extrude contains the critical dimensions that define the basic outline of the part. I could have designed this part with only one feature, with everything all in one sketch. This approach may seem efficient, but it is quite problematic and has several drawbacks. First, if I capture everything in one sketch, I end up with a very complex sketch that is difficult to create and work with. And if I turn on the relations, it is even more cluttered. I would much rather work with this sketch and this set of relations. I could simplify this further by having the hole in a separate feature. However, the 3/8 radius feature is based on the location of the hole, so it makes sense to have it here. This situation is much easier to create and work with. Second, by having the cuts and fillets as separate features, I can control and edit them a lot easier. It is much easier to see only the critical dimensions of each feature. I don't need to see all the dimensions of the entire part if I am only interested in one feature. If I wanted to make a change to any of these features, why do I need to see all of the dimensions for the entire part? Thirdly, with these features separated, I can easily suppress them if I need to. I have been in many situations where features like fillets and chamfers are not needed when a part is inserted into a large assembly. Being able to create a simplified configuration of a part by suppressing unnecessary features is a technique often used to improve large assembly performance. Of course, that is not the case here, but I will still choose this method for the reasons stated above. There is very little benefit to capturing everything in a single sketch. I created a cut for the slots that join with the slots of the front and back supports. The height and widths of the slots allow for a small clearance. The upper slot is positioned so the faceplate will rest on the groove in the front support. I cut a simple triangle on the side to reduce material. This would be a great place for an artistic design similar to what I did on the faceplate. A few fillets are added to finish the part. The last sketch is added for a point used to create the rubber band in the context of the assembly. Since the part is extruded with the mid-plane extrusion, I can use the same sketch plane, in this case, the right plane. The back support is modeled pretty much the same as the front. The back has a notch that accommodates a rib on the basket arm, allowing it to rotate down further. A full round fillet is added to the notch area and a fillet on the corners to match those on the front support. The supports and side plates were then put together in an assembly. I designed the remaining parts in the context of the assembly. This is sometimes referred to as top-down assembly modeling. This approach is similar in some respects to multi-body part design. For this particular model, I want to use the size and position of features from the front support and side plates to assist in the creation of the features of the faceplate. For the initial boss extrude, I used convert entities to capture where the faceplate will rest on the ledge cut into the front support and positioned the rest of the sketch centered on the upper slot in the side plates. This is then extruded in both directions with up to surface end conditions to the inside faces of the side plates. I'll hide the side plate and create the geometry that will join the faceplate to the side plate. The first boss is slightly smaller than the slot depth of the side plate for a sure fit. The next boss is a small tab. The single dimension allows for a small tolerance slightly larger than the width of the side plate, which is 1/8 inch. This is followed by a round fillet, and these features are then mirrored to the other side. Placing a sketch on the front plane of the faceplate part, I extrude a boss for a striking surface for the basket arm. I used a draft feature so I could add a small draft to the side faces of the boss for a little more thickness where it contacts the top of the faceplate. I added some fillets to the edges and a rib for added support with fillets to clean that area up as well. For the design, I placed a sketch with a sketch picture of a typical Roman shield design and traced the geometry to create the cut through the faceplate. When you design a part in the context of an assembly, the part is initially created as a virtual part. It is given a generic name and only resides in the assembly. No file is created. You need to give the part a name, and if you want it to be a separate file, you need to save it in an external file. This is typically what I do. Another thing to be aware of is the external references that are created. With this situation, the faceplate is referencing three separate parts: the front support and both side plates with references in the sketch and the end condition of the extruded boss. In many cases, it is desirable to break these references once the geometry is created. I will do this depending on the design situation. I did not feel the need to break external references for this simple project. The basket is created using the same process. An up-to-surface end condition with a slight offset for clearance is used to create the initial boss extrude feature. The second uses an offset circle from the hole in the side plate, again providing clearance to freely rotate. This is then mirrored to the other side. Using the striking surface created on the faceplate as a guide, I sketch on the front plane of the basket part, a rectangle long enough for the basket, and extrude it a half inch. I added draft to the side faces mainly because I thought the taper would look cool. To create the basket, I use a half circle centered at the top of the arm and revolve it 90 degrees in both directions. I then follow this with a revolved cut offset from the basket revolve an eighth of an inch. I created a rib on the back of the arm for strength, and then a hook for the rubber band extruded the width of the rib. A series of fillets finished the part. Lastly, I placed a sketch with construction geometry that will serve as points to create the rubber band, like I did on the side plate. This part is symmetrical, and as such, all the sketches of the features used in this are placed on the front plane of the part. I try to keep this in mind as I'm designing anything, and so far I have not needed to add any reference planes to any of the parts in this model. All I've done here is used a spline in a 3D sketch attached to the center points of the construction circles in the sketches and positioned the spline with relations that make the spline appear to loop around the tabs of one side plate and connect to the back of the basket. A circle was then swept along this path, creating a sweep feature. This was then mirrored to the other side. Simple. The ball is a half circle revolved 360 degrees. Once the files are completed and I'm satisfied with the design, I'll open a part, choose Save As, select STL for the type, and save the file to my hard drive. The main parts of the body can all be nested and printed at the same time. The faceplate needs to be oriented with the strike feature pointing up. The angle is slight enough that no support material is needed. The front support is oriented so the groove that the faceplate sits on is pointing up. No support material at all. The basket is an odd shape. I oriented the part so the face of the basket is facing up and used organic support structures. This way, any cleanup is affecting the backside of the part. This is a great project that can be used to teach a variety of basic to advanced modeling concepts, such as top-down assembly modeling, adding draft to features, ribs, revolves, 3D sketching, and even sketch pictures. A catapult is a fantastic tool for teaching various STEM principles. Concepts can include projectile motion, energy, angles and trajectories, lever mechanics, and elastic forces. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned to this channel for upcoming projects in the Useful SOLIDWORKS Design Projects You Can Make playlist. And if you found this content helpful, visit the site below to access more content for designing with SOLIDWORKS.